Hey, Prairi, thanks for joining us today to talk about your generative AI journey. So first of all, to ground us, maybe could you tell us a little bit about Smartsheet?
Absolutely. So Smartsheet is a software as a service platform that targets end users or business users for managing work. And when I say managing work, you know, think about projects that are happening in the organization or processes that are running. And we serve customers all the way from a small, you know, boutique architecture firm, which is driving construction projects, to some of the largest organizations in the world, like Amazon. We have a lot of teams across Amazon that use Smartsheet to drive work, drive projects and programs and processes.
That's awesome. In Smartsheet, Prairi, can you tell us a little bit about your current role and how you got here? I know we used to work together a while ago, so I'd love to know your journey and your current role then.
Yeah, so actually my role just expanded here at Smartsheet. I'm now the president for all of product and innovation for Smartsheet. I started here 5 years ago as the CTO for the company. So took over all of the engineering and sort of the service and the development of that, as well as a lot of the security functionality and the information security component. And then a couple of years in, my role expanded to include product. And so then I became the chief product officer and EVP of engineering. And most recently, I expanded it to now include some of our digital marketing investments as well as corp dev function for, you know, strategic partnerships and pricing and packaging and things like that. So just a broad remit as part of the leadership team to be responsible for all of the product and the innovation of the business.
So what role does cloud and AWS play? Can you share a little bit more on your frame of mind and how you think about it? So
one of the things that we did when I came on board at Smartsheet in the CTO role is we moved out of the data centers, our service, our SaaS offering, out of the data centers and onto the AWS platform. So that was a kind of one of the first things I did about a year into my journey at Smartsheet. And so a large portions of our software stack, right, the software as a service stack, runs on AWS, right? So we use vast majority of AWS services, and not only in our commercial region, but also our FedGov region. So we take advantage of, so we have a FedGov instance. We also have an EU instance, which runs out of the Frankfurt region. So the heart of Smartsheet runs on AWS, and we leverage many of your services, including, of course, the AI services.
Specifically for Smartsheet, how do you use generative AI on AWS? Can you share more?
Sure. So before I talk about generative AI, I want to just sort of step back a little bit and talk about AI in general, Swami. So 3+ years ago, as we became cloud native, one of the things we started using, which is one of your services, is SageMaker. Generative AI is a great sort of next step in the journey of taking advantage of artificial intelligence. But we started several years ago, and some of our core experiences in the product, like suggestions, suggested assets, and what sort of you is we leverage SageMaker to actually build the model and make recommendations to our users. So the journey sort of starts even back several years. The generative AI capabilities and the large language models started to become industrial strength, right? Which sort of happened basically about a year and a half ago, right? And so it became very clear as we got into last year, it became very clear that now was the time where we start making some investments in leveraging the generative AI capabilities. And the way I like to talk about it is that in some ways, you know, technologies take a long curve to get to that level of maturation. So I sort of talk about it as 40 years in the making. It is probably one of the best gifts we could have gotten as a no-code work management platform, right? Because our end users, you know, our end users are not like AWS end users, which are developers. Our end users are an average business user. So when they have to write a formula, right, that's cognitive load. How do we reduce cognitive load where they can actually just use natural language to express their intent and we can do the things for them? So we truly believe like this is in some ways one of the best gifts we could have gotten. And so we jumped on it last year. We reorganized several and started making several investments. We're doing some very fun things using the generative AI, solving problems that are really hard otherwise to do for an end user.
That's awesome. It's almost like Gen AI is becoming like integral part of your customer experience for a Smartsheet user. Maybe just double clicking on it. Can you share a little more on, I know in addition to SageMaker and other Gen AI services, you have started and started using Amazon Q Business. So I'd love to know, what are some of the challenges you are trying to solve by using Gen AI, especially something like at Q Business?
Yeah, so Amazon Q is sort of another gift to us. So one of the ways we're using that, what we did, actually one of the engineering leaders at my team took Amazon Q and used the connector to Slack and built this bot. We call it the Ask Me bot. And there's so much information that's locked up in Slack at Smartsheet, yeah? Because teams have these Ask Me channels where, you know, the salespeople can ask a question about the product, or they can ask a legal question from the legal team around the contract. So there are all these Ask Me or Ask Us channels in Slack, and they're public channels where any employee can go ask a question, right? And as you can imagine, over time, the same questions keep getting asked over and over again, right? And so the beautiful thing about the Ask Me bot that uses Q is it actually indexes and all the information that is in these channels, and you can now ask a question off the Ask Me bot, and it gives you the answer. You don't have to go searching through the channel. It just gives you a very concise answer. We use Slack also for incident response. So Slack is where we track when an incident happens. So which is also a public channel. Ask Me can actually summarize the incident for you, so we can do a post-incident review. In Amazon terms, it will be a COE. Teams use it very broadly now. It's a boon to teams. Simple things like, in Slack, you're having this conversation, and if you don't catch up with that conversation for 2 days, there could be hundreds of messages, and you can ask me bot to summarize the entire thread for you, and just massive amounts of productivity gains for the team.
That's amazing. Actually, it's enabling a lot of, sounds like, internal productivity as much as also enabling external use cases. Just as a pure builder, I would love to pick your brain on, like, how did you go about, why did you choose Amazon Q? How did, let's say, security and privacy, did it factor in your addition? If so, how? I'd love to maybe learn more on some of the thought process you went through as you were making some of these choices.
Yeah. I mean, you know, we're a big Amazon customer, an AWS customer in particular. So we're very well versed with the AWS services. But I'll also say generative AI is a kind of a new space, and there's a lot of innovation happening, and not just at AWS, but also sort of in industry in general. And so in some ways, I have chosen to empower the team, right? So my engineers are exploring options out there, looking at like where do we get the models and the efficacy of the models and the speed of the models, as well as some of the security and data isolation properties, right, with respect to that. And so we're still, I would argue, we're still early days in this journey, right? As we learn how different models perform, what some of the data protection and data isolation properties of them are, so there are several things we have done with the Bedrock team, the Q example I shared with you, and others as well. So
you're saying, hey, the sheer fact that Q comes with built-in actually security and access control for your data connectors, That has simplified a lot of this, is what inherently you're excited about from the queue side. Is that correct?
Definitely. So in part because of the trust we place in AWS as a partner and a vendor, right?
Yeah.
And me personally having lived there has an element to it, right? I know Dave Brown, I know many of you folks, and how much the culture at AWS is with respect to protecting the customer and protecting customer data. And so I think those kinds of that level of trust and plays an important role in these
thank you. And we don't take this trust lightly, and we work hard, as you know, and you have been on the inside too. And Q, again, actually, because of the ability where the security and access control gets built in, it actually provides these benefits. Got it. Now, I ask this question to a lot of execs I meet, especially who have gone through some of the AI journey, and especially having built new experiences with generative AI. So I'm curious to get your take. What is take on what is possible now that wasn't possible even a year or two ago? So are there any quantifiable metrics you have, and can be like cost, scale, speed, or optimization? Anything you can share there?
I think there are productivity gains to be had at many different levels, right? The queue example and the ask me bot example in the context of Slack is just one of those examples where one of the most active users, we built that thing to help engineering teams. That's where we started, right? But it turned out it got this viral adoption across the company, right? In fact, the newest employees in the company who are actually trying to learn and get answers to their questions are the most active users, because, you know, there's a lot of hesitation to go to some other human and ask them a question, where if I have a smart chatbot and I can ask the question and it answers for me, right? Like, you get so hooked to that, right? It just sort of reduces the barrier. And so that's the sort of the queue example. But I think our developers are using, you know, tools using generative AI-based tools for code writing as well. I think there are lots of examples I can sort of say where it's very clear. My engineers, many of my best engineers will tell you that they would never write code without now having the generative AI capability to help them sort of do some of that authoring, right? And so we're seeing the impact of that transcend many job functions across the organization.
That actually is a really good, fascinating anecdote. It resonates even internally. We are seeing, like, when internal Amazon developers use Amazon Q, the developer service, especially new developers learning a new code base, the first thing they do is actually ask you to summarize the code and or explain it or various other things. It's in the same way. Then it becomes an integral part of their workflow and how they work. So what you're saying actually really resonates in a big way in terms of how others are doing what they're doing in Slack or how they are operating in Smartsheet and so forth. Maybe a couple more questions if you had time. For others who are interested in using AWS Gen AI services and then trying to achieve big needle moving business outcomes, what are some of your advices? Like, here are the things actually you have to watch out for, here are the things you need to prioritize. What are some of the things you would advise them?
Yeah, I think the number one thing I would advise anybody who's questioning or doubting it is, like, jump in, right? And the reason I say that is because I think there's a lot of lack of knowledge, right? And I'll call it the FUD, the fear, uncertainty, and doubt, right? Sort of a simple example of that is, are these models going to learn about my company information? And so I kind of tell people, you know, actually the model builders are really worried that you will corrupt their models, because these models are built with very carefully with respect to the parameters. And they are statistical models. So, and, you know, people don't have simple information like how tokenization actually works. So I think people have to, it's a bit of a leap for a lot of people who think, because it feels like magic. In long days, right? So it feels like magic. And so when you see that feels like magic, you don't want to trust it. And so I think that's part of it. Is I think we as technologists have seen over the last 30 plus years, right? Like when internet and the computers hit each other, right? And what it has done for the world, right? It's sort of, I think Gen AI is that kind of disruption in technology, which like internet was. And so I think it's that level and that scale of thing, and people who are sitting on the sidelines need to really jump in and start figuring out how they benefit from it.
You're saying don't wait, jump right in, but second aspect is seek to understand how these systems work so that you know the nuances of what it can do, what it cannot do, so that they know how to what outcomes to expect. Both are equally important. It's actually really good advice and good call out. Looking ahead, now you're already using SageMaker and already actually leveraging Bedrock. And as you saw, some of our we launched a capability to connect SageMaker to Bedrock with custom model import and with Q launches and so forth. What else are you exploring as part of your Gen AI strategy and your product? I mean, you can share how much ever you're comfortable sharing, but I'm just curious to know how you are actually thinking about the future.
I think we're very early in the journey. And so I don't know if I could share much more right now as we're sort of building our next layer of plans. And I will say that I think our teams are doing some experimentation right now with things like dashboards and how we can extract information from dashboards, as an example, right? So even in the SageMaker world, right, it wasn't just the recommendations. We actually used the SageMaker in our search experience as well. And we saw double-digit improvement in terms of rankings because we were able to use SageMaker capability to improve our search experience in the product. So we'll find lots of places, Swami, I think, as teams get more and more comfortable with the technologies, right? Like a simple example is like prompt engineering, right? RAG and prompt engineering. Our engineers are getting more and more comfortable with using these tools like they learn to use the cloud services tools, right? And so it's that as they learn more, new ideas are going to spark and we're going to see amazing innovation through that.
That totally makes sense. You're saying having access to that technology is going to spark a lot of new innovations from ground up, and you're going to see more and more innovation, especially with these amazing technologies. I'll stop here, but it was really great to catch up, to learn more about your Gen AI strategy and how you're innovating with Amazon Q and SageMaker and Bedrock. And I really do hope we continue to partner more together as we as you continue to hack the sheet and Smartsheet. Really excited about it. All right. Thank you.
I expect as much. Thank you.